It's nice to be here and nice to see you. And okay, so it's going to be four lectures about free and hyperbolic groups. Basically, this is an introductory lecture. So, but if, I don't know, you have different backgrounds. So, I mean, you stop me if it is too fast, or you tell me if you know everything. I don't know, like, let's try how it goes and see what we can do. The first and the second lectures are on the internet, so there are notes for the first lecture, so you can take them there. And I am going to have some exercise during lectures, which we are going probably to do during this hour on the grass or whatever here. Okay, so the object of our study are finitely generated groups given by presentations. So we have generators for the group and relations, where like relations are words in these generators. So these relations, like I am post, so these words are equal to one in the group. And also, such a group is a quotient of a free group, which I'm going to talk about, generated by A1, An, over the normal subgroup generated by these elements, R1, R2, and so on. Now, for example, so-called free Burnside group, it's a group of exponent N. We can define a group by two generators, A and B, and say that n's power of each element is equal to 1. So u is any element of the group. So this is a free Burnside group. And there was a famous Burnside problem, whether such group is finite or infinite. Like, for example, if you take n equals 2, you're going to have an abelian group, two generators. So if a square of each element is equal to 1, so the group is finite. If a cube of each element is equal to 1, the group is also finite. Such a group is also finite. It's finite for 4, for 6, it's not known for 5, and infinite for large n. Like another example of a group given by a presentation, a surface group. This is a fundamental group of orientable surface of genus n. 2n generators, and the product of n commutators is equal to 1. But we'll come back to this. So these are just examples now. Okay, so let's talk about a free group. So if you have an arbitrary set of elements S, like a word in S is a finite sequence of elements, which we write like this. So it's a finite string of elements in S. So this is a word. Usually people, whatever, understand it intuitively, but you know, sometimes. So it's a finite string of elements in S. Now, this number n is the length of the word, and we denote it by length of w. Now, empty sequence is also allowed, and the empty word is denoted by e, and the length of the empty word is 0, right? Now, how to define, like, algebraic way to define a free group? Free group generated by a set, by the set S. So we also consider set S inverse. It's a set of formal inverses of these elements in S. And take the union of S and the set of formal inverses. So this is an alphabet of a free group. Of a group which you're going to construct. And now by S to the power of 1, we just mean S. And S to the power minus 1, it is S inverse. Okay, now expression of this type. So we have a word in this alphabet, S plus minus 1. It's called a group word. Okay? And then the word is called reduced if it contains no subwords of the form S, S inverse, or S inverse S. Now, the group is a free group. Group G is called a free group if there exists a generating set S, it's free group on the set S, such that every non-empty reduced word, reduced group word in S, defines a non-trivial element. Okay, so Like we have reduced words. Multiplication is concatenation of these reduced words and then reduction, right? And in inversion, like if you have a word, like let's say S1, S2, then the inverse of S1, S2 is going to be S2 inverse, S1 inverse. One has to check that this all works, but it works. Okay, so in this case, so the group of all reduced words with these operations is called a free group on the set S. S is free basis of the group. Now, there is only one like little problem. So let's discuss how we obtain a reduced word from an arbitrary word. So we have a reduction process, right? So for example, like suppose we have a word S inverse S2, S2 inverse S3, S4 inverse S4, S4 inverse S5. Okay, so we can do reductions. We can do this reduction, right? Then here, okay, we can do either this one or that one. And then finally, it's a finite word. So finally, we will obtain a reduced word. The only little like problem is, do we obtain the same word? I mean, we can do reductions different way, right? So we have to prove, and this is going to be your first exercise, that that if we do, suppose we have two reductions, so every reduction is a sequence of elementary reductions, like this. So one reduction is an elementary reduction. Every reduction is a sequence of elementary reductions. So the exercise is to prove that if we do like different sequences of elementary reductions, we have the same result. So this is all well defined, like having a word. We have a unique reduced form of this word. Okay, and then like this reduced words form a group, which is a free group. So this is our definition. Now, a free group is actually a free object in the category of groups on the set S. Now, so what does this mean? So actually, we are going to, again, you are going to prove the theorem that a free group defined as a set of reduced words, the alphabet S, is actually a free object in the category of groups. What does this mean? So this means that, so we have the set S. There is an inclusion map of S in F. And suppose that there is a map of sets S into some other group G. Then there is a unique homomorphism from F to this group G, such that like this diagram commutes. Okay, so every map of sets from S to some other group can be like extend to a homomorphism from a free group generated by S into this group. Again, like there is something to verify here. And I mean, we are not talking about categories here because too little time, but so this means that it is a free object in the category of groups. Okay, and then so every group given by like generators A1IN and relations, any set of relations, is actually a quotient of a free group generated by this element A1IN over the normal closure, like normal subgroup generated by these relators, right? I mean, so again, one uses isomorphism theorems to prove this. But basically, if you have this group, then there is a map of sets, like from a set A1AN into this group, right? And it can be extended to a homomorphism. And the kernel of this homomorphism is exactly the normal closure of this, of the set of relators. Okay, so like presentations of group given by generators and relators came from topology. These are like, there are famous, I mean, not only from topology, certainly from, like, I mean, Galois groups also, so they used generators, but from topology, at least some algorithmic problems for groups given by generators and relations were first inspired by topology, the so-called dense problems. For example, the word problem. Word problem, so if you have a presentation, it is a presentation. Okay, so if you have a word in these generators, the first question we want to answer is this word equal to one or not? Or if two words are equal, two words are equal, this means that like U equals W if and only if like UW inverse is equal to one. So we have to be able to decide if the word is equal to one. And it answers important questions about fundamental group of topological space. But it turned out that in general, this problem is, okay, let me just open this all. So in general, this problem is undecidable. There is a famous solution of Boone and Novikov of dense problem, so that there exists a finitely presented group. Finitely presented means finite number of generators and finite number of relators with undecidable word problem. So there is no algorithm given a word to decide if this word is identity or not. So, I mean, this shows that algorithmically, I mean, the class of groups. It is a specific group. You can construct this group. Like you take a Turing machine with undecidable halting problem and basically do the interpretation. It's very easy to do it in a free monoid or a free semigroup. You just write commands of this Turing machine as relators and you don't know like whether like the final configuration will, whatever, you say that final configuration is zero if it is a semigroup or one, and like you'll get a free semigroup, not free semigroup, you'll get a semigroup with undecidable word problem. But for groups, basically, it was done in 1952, I believe. And for semigroups, it was done in 1936, immediately after Church-Turing thesis was formulated, right? Because to say that something is undecidable, you have to know what is decidable. At least you have to have a like precise notion of an algorithm. It's easy to say like that the algorithm exists, so then there is a finite set of instructions to do something. But before Church-Turing thesis, it was kind of not formally defined like what is the algorithm, and then so the algorithm is something which can be whatever done by a Turing machine with a finite set of instructions like an infinite tape. And if there is no such a Turing machine halting on our input, so then there is no algorithm. So the difficulty was that group has cancellations, so you can cancel a lot of elements, so you cannot write a sequence of commands of Turing machine, you cannot just whatever write corresponding relations and relax, because it can be cancellations, so you cannot interpret it immediately, so they had to work on this. Okay, then the second theorem. Also, often, so the word problem is a problem, but very often when we have a group, we are talking about a word problem as a set of words in a free group which are equal to one in this group. So we say that it's a word problem, the group. So Higman proved that group has recursively enumerable word problem. So there is an algorithm enumerating elements, if and only if it is a subgroup of a finitely presented group. And then, another, so I'm just talking about classical results, so what was done in old times. So, and then Adyan Novikov's solution of the Burnside problem, that the free Burnside group, you remember the group of exponent when every element has exponent n, is infinite for large odd n. Later on it was proved it's infinite for like n, which is a power of two. But
mm-hmm.
No, because in a free Burnside group, What is a free group? So every reduced word represents a non-trivial element, right? And in the free Bernstein group, like whatever generated by A and B, then we have A to the N is equal to 1. It is a reduced word, but it is equal to 1. So there are relations. And it is, as I said, for N equals 5, it is an open problem. Two generators and the identity, every element to exponent 5 is equal to 1. It's an open problem whether the group is infinite or finite. Don't do it. I mean, it's not a good problem for a graduate student or a postdoc. When you're like old and tired, you can can spend some time. Or again, maybe someone young just has some brilliant idea. Okay, now another famous result, and actually we start talking about geometry in groups, because now sort of combinatorial group theory became a part of geometric group theory, which we're going to talk about. So this is like, we're talking about growth rate. So it's a well-defined notion from asymptotic analysis, and to say that finitely generated group has polynomial growth means that the number of elements of length n relative to the symmetric generating set like S plus or minus 1. The set of elements of length n is of length at most n is bounded above by a polynomial function of n. So there exists a polynomial P of n. Like you can check, for example, take free abelian group, right, with two generators. So how many elements of length n do you have, like, of it, what it can be? Like, it's a to the k, b to the whatever n minus k, right? So you'll get a polynomial. Like, so all the elements length n look like this, if it is a abelian group. No. In the free group, it's going to be exponential function. It's easy to show. So polynomial growth. So we say that group has polynomial growth if the set of elements of length less or equal than n bounded by some fixed polynomial. Like. Now, a nilpotent group. Do you know what is a nilpotent group? Everybody knows, right? So the lower central series and the identity. Okay, so and then Gromov proved that any group of polynomial growth has a nilpotent subgroup of finite index. It's not difficult to prove the converse. So a group has polynomial finitely generated group has a polynomial growth if and only if it has a nilpotent subgroup of finite index. It is an amazing result because growth is sort of geometric notion or asymptotic notion, right? And to be a nilpotent group is an algebraic property of a group. So they are closely related. Okay, now let's introduce more geometry to groups. So, okay, so, the group G is given as a quotient of a free group on set of S. So it's given by this presentation. Now we know what is the word length already, so it's the smallest integer n such that G is a represented by this word of length n. Now the word metric, we can define a metric, integer metric on the group. So the distance between two elements is going to be defined as G1 inverse G2, the length of G1 inverse G2. And G acts on itself from the left by isometries. Then, like, I mean, multiplication on the left gives an isometry, right? It's So the distance between G1 and G2 is the same as the distance between GG1 and GG2, right? Because like G1 inverse G2 is the same as G1 inverse G inverse G2, right? Also, one can define a graph, the so-called Kelly graph. The vertices of this graph are going to be, so like first of all, we turn the group into a metric space with metric in integers. You can check that it is actually a metric. We can associate to each group a Kelly graph. Vertices of the Kelly graph are just elements of the group. And we draw an edge between two vertices which are at distance 1, right? So if there are two vertices at distance 1, like for example G, and then it must be like the other element should be G times some, what is the generating set S? So we draw edges between elements like this. And we can even label these edges by the corresponding generator. So then we're going to have a Kelly graph.
This is directed
graph. It is a directed graph, yes. It is a directed graph, but if we consider this as a, I mean, we also can go against the direction, right? So if we go in this direction, we read element S. If we go in the opposite direction, we read S inverse. So we can go both ways, but it is a directed graph. So it is a metric space. And even like later, actually we can on the Kelly graph, we can even define the metric into reals, right? Like real metric, because we can identify each edge with a unit interval. And then the metric is going to be just a path metric. So the distance between two elements, points in the Kelly graph, it is just the distance of the short path, the length of the short path between them. And now this turns a group into a geometric object immediately. Now this is a Kelly graph of a free group. Now, a Kelly graph of a free group is not seen very well here. Basically, it is an infinite tree, right? Let me just do it here. This is a Kelly graph of the free group with two generators on the picture. If you Google Kelly graph of a group, you'll see a lot of beautiful pictures online. So I'm stealing some pictures from there, especially tomorrow I'm going to steal a lot of pictures from Tim Riley. Okay, so you have identity, so this is a vertex, right? And then you have, okay, A, B, then A, this is A inverse, right? And this is B, like this way we read B inverse, so I just put an arrow and write B. Okay, and then here we can go B, A, and then it is A, B, and so on. So we're going to have an infinite tree. Why it is a tree? Because, I mean, if we have a loop, now what is a loop? A loop is a closed like path such that the initial vertex is the same as the terminal vertex, right? If you have a loop, this would mean that there is a relation in the group, right? Because this means that like we multiply one by this generator, another generator, another generator, another generator, another generator, another generator, and come back to one. So this word, the label of this loop, is going to be equal to one. And we know that in a free group, every reduced word is defines a non-trivial element. So we're going to have an infinite tree of valency or degree 4, right? So if the group is given by n generators, then the degree of the Kelly graph is 2n. So for each vertex, we have to have a like h labeled by element and inverse of this element. Now that's another example. Consider the dihedral group D3, so the group of symmetries of a regular triangle. So it's generated by two elements. A is rotation, B is reflection. And these are the relations. So rotation cube is 1, reflection square is equal to 1, and this is like the product of ABAB is equal to 1. And this is a Kelly graph. So you can see like A cube, and if you multiply A by B, you get here. So like the graph has 6 vertices as the group, and this is a okay. Now we can define more like rigorously what is polynomial growth. Like a ball of radius n in the Kelly graph, it is a set of all elements of length less or equal than n. And the group has a polynomial growth if and only if the number of elements in Bn is bounded by a polynomial. Now, the growth function of a free group is actually going to be exponential. So this is an exercise to prove that a free group doesn't have a polynomial growth. The growth can be polynomial. Also, we have to talk, but maybe not now, about equivalence of, like asymptotic equivalence of functions. But basically, the growth is exponential if it's bounded from below by the exponent. And there are groups of intermediate growth, which is not polynomial, not exponential, and it's a whole big area of in geometric group theory studying the growth of groups. Okay, now like the second, our second here is going to be hyperbolic groups. So let me just give a definition now, and we will like return later to their properties. Okay, so so geodesic metric space, one of the definition of delta hyperbolic geodesic metric spaces is that for any geodesic triangle in this metric space, like take three elements in the metric space and draw arbitrary geodesics between them, right? Then we have a triangle. This triangle is called a geodesic triangle. And so in a delta hyperbolic metric space, every geodesic, so there exists number delta fixed from the beginning, such that every geodesic triangle is delta thin. This means that the distance from each edge to the union of two other edges is less than delta. Okay, so triangles look like this in hyperbolic spaces. For example, like if delta is zero, we're talking about real tree or R3. And the group is hyperbolic if the Kelly graph is hyperbolic. And hyperbolic groups were, they were introduced by different people, but like in, I think, 1989, I think Gromov published a book called Hyperbolic Group, where he gave work to a lot of mathematicians by writing this book, because first it was like completely new area, he had some hints of proofs instead of proofs, and so a lot of people were like working hard but it was like great intuition, and so again, like hyperbolic groups and their generalizations now, like so-called negatively curved groups, form a big, again, big area in geometric group theory. Actually, Gulnara is probably going to tell you that almost every group is hyperbolic. Like, if you look at the things probabilistically, that you can introduce the measure on the set of groups, almost every group is hyperbolic. Okay. What is like the important question? So I gave a definition. Kelly graph is a hyperbolic geodesic metric space for a hyperbolic group. What would be the natural question to, like, or whatever, natural concern here? Do you have any natural concerns about what I said?
Okay.
Yes, exactly, right, excellent. So the Cayley graph depends on the generating set, right? If you have a Cayley graph of a group, it depends on the generating set, right? I can define the same free group, I can define like this, A, B, C, and to say that, okay, C is A square B cube, right? And then I'm going to have different Cayley graph. It's still going to be a free group because I can get rid of C, right? It is just a word in A and B. So it's the same group. But just A, B, and C do not form a free basis of this group. And the Cayley graph is going to be different. It's going to, vertex is going to have valency 6, right? And we're going to have circles and so on. So Cayley graph certainly depends on the set of generators. So why am I saying that the group is hyperbolic if the Cayley graph with respect to some generating set is hyperbolic? So I have to make sure that it is hyperbolic with respect to every generating set, right? And okay, for this we need the notion of quasi-isometry. So quasi-isometry, so suppose we have two metric spaces. So with a distance function x with dx and y with dy. Take two real numbers, k greater or equal than 1 and c greater or equal than 0. Now, a map f from x to y is called kc quasi-isometry if we have these two properties. So what the properties tell us? So first of all, the distance in y between images of two elements, it's not very different in a sense from the distance in x, right? Because it's bounded from above by this. So you have to multiply distance in x by k and add this number c. And bounded from below by like 1 over k times distance in x minus c. So that's the first property. So the distance in y is not very different from the distance of x. In x, certainly, I mean, it can be quite different, right? K can be a large number, but nevertheless, so it's a fixed number. And second, the C neighborhood of the image of x is all of y. Okay, so all y is in the C neighborhood of the image. We don't require it to be bijection or whatever. No, just these two properties. Now, okay, examples. Simplest example, integers with natural distance and real numbers with natural distance, right? So what would be the map from integer to reals? What would be this map? Yes, right, just embed integers into reals, like, and extend the distance function. Then what we have? Actually, this number k is just going to be 1, right? And and we'll take c equals 1/2, because we have to have the second property that all y is a real sign 1/2 neighborhood of the integers, right? Okay, so this is, and you can prove that then there is an inverse map, which, like, so we can talk about quasi-isometric equivalence. So two metric spaces are quasi-isometric if there is this map. Again, would be a good exercise to do this. And also, I call this geometric properties of hyperbolic spaces. The book of Breiden and Hefliger is a good source. And it is also, you can find it online. I mean, the whole book, I don't know how it came there, but it's been online for a long time. Okay, another example. That's more complicated, but we can prove that all free groups with more than two generators, more or equal than two generators, are quasi-isometric, using this lemma. Suppose we have a regular tree of valency at least three. So all such trees are quasi-isometric. So it is this picture, I'm just going to show that regular tree of, so this is T3, regular tree of valency 3, right? I'll construct a quasi-isometry from this tree to a regular tree of valency 6. But completely the same way it can be done for any like k, for regular tree of valency k. So we define this map Q. So we send all edges drawn in thin lines into themselves, and all paths of length k minus 3, in this case it is 6 minus 3, so path of length 3, this bold path, into a point, into one vertex. Okay, then, let's see. Suppose we'll just send this path into one vertex. So then the valency is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? The map is surjective. And you can check this inequality. So this is like how to construct quasi-isometry. And basically what you do, like you have these three bold edges, and then you have like two thin edges, and then again, arbitrarily, you take three bold edges, just make sure that there is one thin edge from like vertex, this vertex and that vertex. And you can construct it, like this map. Okay, so all non-abelian, there's a corollary, we have that all non-abelian free groups of finite rank are quasi-isometric to each other. Okay, and the Kelly graph we already discussed. But now, so if a metric space is quasi-isometric to a delta hyperbolic metric space, right, then doing some, you also have to show that you have to talk about quasi-geodesics here, but then basically you show that geodesic triangle goes into quasi-geodesic triangle. Again, a good exercise to maybe we will work on this. Then it is delta one hyperbolic. So it's so if a group is hyperbolic, if the Kelly graph is hyperbolic with one set of generators. Then we have to also, we have to prove more. We have to prove that the Kelly graph with respect to one set of generators is quasi-isometric to the Kelly graph with respect to the other set of generators. And this is going to be like another exercise. Now, this is what? This is the definition. Ooh. How much time do I have? We started at 9:15, not at 9, because I just afraid. So, okay, then, right, this is about Kelly graphs. This we discussed already. Okay, another properties, not properties, examples. Every bounded metric space is quasi-isometric to a point. So, for example, all finite groups are quasi-isometric, right? And quasi-isometric to a trivial group. Just take this constant C, like large enough, take it larger than the perimeter of this graph, and then you're going to have quasi-isometry. Then this is going to be our exercise. So if you have two finite generating sets for a group, then metric space is like this group with distance defined by a first generating set and distance defined by a second generating set are quasi-isometric. Now, actually, I mean, again, like studying quasi-isometric spaces is an important and large area of geometric group theory. Maybe like due to this, so if you have a compact Riemannian manifold, universal cover, and fundamental group of the manifold, then the group is finitely generated and even finitely presented. But then the universal cover and the fundamental group of the manifold with some word metric are quasi-isometric. So it's one of the like examples of which partly justifies studying quasi-isometries. And then, okay, oops, yeah, last thing. If you have a finite index subgroup of a group G, then again, the group and its finite index subgroup are quasi-isometrically equivalent. Again, exercise. When we have a group, so the word metric is the distance between G1, G2 is length of G1 inverse G in this generating set. Yeah, so like, I mean, the word metric is basically, as soon as we select generators, like we have a word metric on the group. So, with respect to some word metric. But I mean, what we can do, we can take a generating set. So first take generating set of G1, and then just extend it to a generating set of G. We know that like being quasi-isometric does not depend on the generating set. Like, I mean, yeah, that groups with respect to two generating sets are quasi-isometric. So you can first select convenient generating sets, and then like then it's true for every generating set. Okay, so this is basically it's not only quasi-isometric, but so-called Bay-Lipschitz equivalent. This means that this constant C is zero, can be taken zero in the definition of quasi-isometry. Okay, and now do I have to yes, let's do this. Gromov suggested like the area of study. So classify all, let's say, finitely generated groups up to quasi-isometries. And like, I mean, this is a very, very difficult problem and does not have good answers in general, but certain classes. And then it's convenient to, one can say that the class of groups is complete with respect to quasi-isometry if every group which is quasi-isometric to some group in this class has a subgroup of in this class of finite index. So it's just virtually in this class. For example, finitely presented group. So if a group is quasi-isometric to a finitely presented group, then has a finitely presented group as a subgroup of finite index. Nilpotent groups, abelian groups, a class of abelian groups, complete with respect to quasi-isometry. Hyperbolic groups. So if a group is quasi-isometric to a hyperbolic group, then it is like virtually hyperbolic. If it's virtually hyperbolic, it is hyperbolic. So non-abelian free groups of finite rank. Then amenable groups. Amenable groups actually the topic of Tatiana's lectures next week. Fundamental group of closed three-dimensional manifolds. And actually class of fundamental groups of closed n-dimensional hyperbolic manifolds. Like for n greater or equal than 3. So these are classes of complete with respect to quasi-isometries. There are some other classes, and there are classes which are not complete with respect to quasi-isometries. But like it's an interesting area. Okay, now let me go back to free groups. Now we are going to talk about certain properties of free groups, certain very nice properties of free groups, which later, again, like the class of all groups, it doesn't make sense to study the whole class because like there are groups which are close to being free, like for example, hyperbolic groups, negatively curved groups, and so on. There are groups close to being abelian, and then in between there are monsters and jungles and so on. So free groups have a lot of nice properties, And when we study some class of groups which is sort of close to free groups, first thing we do, we're trying to prove that these groups have this property, so like something like this. So it's like a suggestion to what can be like what can be good in a group which is close to like being free. Like for example, word problem. Like word problem is decidable in a free group, easily decidable, right? Because I mean, how to solve the word problem? Reduce the word, like take the word, reduce it. If you got a non-empty word, it is not equal to one, right? Then, okay, definition of a cyclically reduced word. A word is cyclically reduced if it does not, if yn is not equal to y, is not the inverse of y1, right? So if it's like reduced, if we write it on a circle, basically. For example, like this word is cyclically reduced, and this is not, right? Because it begins with S1 and ends with S1 inverse. So it's not cyclically reduced. But if a word is not cyclically reduced, it's easy to cyclically reduce it, certainly. Now, again, like this is going to be the exercise. What is a conjugacy problem? Conjugacy problem, take two elements in a group, given two elements in a group, decide whether they are conjugate. And, okay, conjugacy problem is also decidable in a free group easily, and this is like, this is going to be the exercise, that two cyclically reduced words are conjugate if and only if one is a cyclic shift of the other. So first of all, if the word is not cyclically reduced, it is conjugate to a cyclically reduced word, right? And then two cyclically reduced are conjugates if and only if they are cyclic shifts of each other. This solves the conjugacy problem. And this is going to be our exercise. Okay, and then there is another problem, isomorphism problem. Again, we have two presentations. Suppose we, most often, like we have two finite presentations of the group. But I mean, these are presentations, so how do we know that these groups are isomorphic or not isomorphic? Like, how do we know that, like, we take two different presentations, we don't even know, like, whether they define the same group. So the isomorphism problem is a problem given two presentations, decide if the groups are isomorphic. And in the class of all finitely presented groups, it is not decidable. There is no algorithm given two finite presentations, decide whether its groups the same, define the same group.
Sorry, so what does this mean?
Okay, the cardinality. Okay, suppose we have like, suppose F is freely generated by a set S and H is freely generated by a set S, H is freely generated by a set U.
Both
are free groups, but with different generating sets. Where does they isomorphic? And the answer is like natural. So when cardinalities of the sets are the same. Like so when cardinalities of the sets are the same. Okay, now prove this. That's again, I mean, it's an exercise. Okay. Also, we can have a topological approach to a free group. I maybe skip Seifert van Kampen theorem because, or maybe I'll return after one slide. But so if you have a rose with S petals, so it's a wedge of S circles. And it's not good that this S and this is also S. So basically, suppose we have this graph. Okay, then what is the fundamental group of a topological space? Take a base point, take homotopy equivalence classes of loops, this base point, and they generate a group. So this is a fundamental group. Now, fundamental group of this graph is a free group of rank four, right? So with four generators, right? Because the fundamental group, I was planning to like to prove this, but I think I'll probably just whatever. It looks like you know things, so you can read it everywhere. Like basically, yeah, the theorem says that if you have a row with S petals, then the fundamental group is free group with basis of S elements, right? And the proof can do it by induction on the number of, like for phi that we generated free groups, you can do it by induction on number of generators. And then, okay, I just have to, and then this is going to be an exercise that the group is free if and only if it is a fundamental group of a graph. It's going to be an exercise because I sort of like to promise Gulnara to define certain things, so I'll hurry a little bit. And then this theorem we will prove later, that every subgroup of a free group is free. Again, it can be easily proved topologically because free group is a fundamental group of a graph. Take a subgroup, take a cover corresponding to the subgroup. Cover of a graph is a graph. So the subgroup of a free group is a free group with more generators. But this we discussed during the next hour. This we skip. Okay, another thing. Schreier's graph. So we know what the Cayley graph is now. One can also, given a subgroup of subgroup H of a group. Now, okay, we have a group G and we have a subgroup H. We consider the set of right cosets of H and form, so this is a set of right cosets, and form the graph similarly to what we did, how we formed the Cayley graph. So vertices are right cosets, and there is an H between, there is an H between coset H, G, and H, G, S for every generator S in, so our group G is generating by the set S. Okay, so again, it is a directed graph. Just instead of elements of the group G, like in the Cayley graph, you have right cosets of the subgroup H. And this is called a Schreier graph. Now, so this can be done for any group G and any subgroup H of G. Mm-hmm. S is a generating set of G. S is a generating set of G. We now, like this definition, it's not just for free group G, for any group G and any subgroup H. But now important, because this is what I promised Gulnara to define in this lecture, the Stalling's graph of a free group. So now, now our group is free. So G is now a free group. Set of generators S, and take a subgroup of a free group. A Stalling's graph of the subgroup denoted by gamma of H. Also, like gamma zero of H, this is my notation for the Schreier graph. So there exists gamma zero of H, Schreier's graph. So take a subgroup H. Now, okay, so Schreier's graph, it is a graph of cosets of H, right? And there is this coset H somewhere in this graph corresponding to the identity element, right? Okay, so now we consider, so the Stalling's graph, gamma of H, is a minimal subgraph of the Schreier's graph containing all loops at this vertex. I mean, there are whatever, so it's I mean, the Schreier graph may be infinite, right? It's actually, it is just the index of the subgroup H, right? If H has infinite subgroup, this is an infinite graph. A Storing's graph, it can be finite to infinite, but if H is finitely generated, then then it's going to be actually a finite graph. This requires some thinking, and we'll probably do it as an exercise. So again, the Stalling's graph is a minimal subgroup of the Schreier graph. And the Stalling's graph, we're only talking about a free group. Like, so now take a free group, take a subgroup of a free group, take a Schreier's graph of this subgroup, and take a set of all loops starting at this vertex, and this is what's called the Stalling's graph. Now, for example, probably give an example and we'll stop here. Okay, so suppose we have a free group given by generators A and B, and then the subgroup H generated by these elements A, A, B, A square, A inverse B square, A, B, A inverse B. Now, this is, I claim that this is a Stalling's graph. So this is our vertex corresponding to coset H. First of all, let's see. I mean, certainly these words corresponding to these elements must be labels of loops, right? Because we multiply, 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 and then we the element, like this element, A, B, A square belongs to H. So H times A, B, A square is the same, right, coset as H, right? So let's see, is it, okay, A, B, where is my A square? Just a minute, let me see, what can I read here? Can I read at least, okay. A inverse B, B, I can read, okay. Then A, B, A inverse B, I can read. A, B, maybe it's a misprint, just. A, B, it should be A here. I mean, it's a misprint here. Mm-hmm. Then I have A, B, A, A. Right? Let's see. No. Let me see. This is a one loop, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay.
This is A inverse. Let's see. I think it's a misprint here.
Yeah, that should be A.
It should be A. Yeah. It should be A. Like. But again, A inverse B, B, then A, B, A inverse B. Yes. I'm not using this H, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And then A, B, it should be A. Ah, no, but then it's... let me see, does it correspond to this?
H, A squared, no.
Then it should be A, B, A. But is it... It probably does not. Okay, it's probably easier to do the graph here and then see what it is. Okay, H. A, B, A, right? A, B, B, A. A, right, Z. Okay, now then I read A inverse B. And then I read AB, A minus 2B. Okay. A, B, A. Ah, no, 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 okay. Uh-huh. Okay, A, B. A inverse, B. Right, okay, so what is the difference with A, B? Yeah, this 1H and this, like, I mean the, this vertex is different, right? So there is a misprint here, and maybe then that's maybe here, I don't know. Okay, so.
Maybe it's good to discuss this in the review session.
Yeah, we will. So let me just finish. So basically, we have a free group, we have a subgroup of a free group. If the subgroup is finitely generated, then there is a part of the Schreier graph of the subgroup, which is called the Stallings graph. And this part consists of all loops beginning at H. And then we'll discuss it like next time in the review section. Thank you.
In view of the time, let's leave questions to the review session. Let's just thank Olga.